each other. If not personally, but certainly by name.
I met David working. He was a heart surgeon at the hospital here in town. I was appointed to be his nurse, and we got to be very good friends.
It was fairly common knowledge in the medical community that David and Stephanie were having an affair.
I immediately was branded with the scarlet letter A.
Stephanie was taunting my mom, was trying to stir up trouble.
His wife killed herself over the affair. How could you not feel guilty? It was terrible.
Stephanie is a master at manipulating men. This woman has come in and just turned everything into a freak show.
This story's gonna have all types of twists and turns and innuendos.
I woke up, he was purple in the face. And I got up and ran around the side and pulled the covers back, and he was not breathing.
I was extremely shocked that he had died.
Somebody cleaned up. Somebody was hiding something.
I know for a fact that Stephanie knows what happened.
David had a terminal illness.
They didn't expect him to live more than a couple of months.
Stephanie wanted people to think my father was very sick because they wouldn't question when he died.
There was an indication from the crime laboratory in Mississippi that there were a particular type of drug in his system.
Somebody wanted his money. Somebody wanted to continue living the lifestyle they were accustomed to.
So I shoved her up against the wall, and I said, you killed my father, and I hope you rot in hell, you bitch.
Just because people don't like me doesn't make me a killer.
The Other Woman, tonight's 48 Hours Mystery. Continues in 90 seconds.
For Kristen Stevens, these scratchy images bring back a lifetime of memories.
Here she is beginning to walk.
And voices from the past.
Put some tape or ribbon in your hair so that everybody knows you're a girl.
Voices of her father, Dr. David Stevens.
He was very loving and caring and tender.
And her mother, Karen.
She was happy if everyone else was happy.
Telling familiar stories.
This is number two.
About how it all began. But 35-year-old Kristen, now with her own family, could never have imagined how it all would end.
How can this have happened to such a normal, everyday apple pie family? I mean, these are the types of things you read about in the headlines or see on TV. They don't happen to your family. And I just can't fathom how one person can have such a huge impact on an entire family.
That person is this woman, Stephanie Stevens, 36, her stepmother, who Kristen says tore her family apart and murdered her father.
I hate her. I wish her nothing but ill will. I think she is an evil person.
Come here.
I'm a good person. I care a lot about other people, and the people that are closest to me know that. It's just that, unfortunately, the bad decisions I've made have all been public folly.
They are two women who love the same man. In Kristen's eyes, he was an adoring father. In Stephanie's, he was the man of her dreams. And in the sleepy town of Hattiesburg, Mississippi, what happened to the prominent surgeon is the stuff that scandals are made of.
If I wrote a book, no one would believe it.
Stephanie's is the story of a small town girl who dreamed of being a beauty queen.
I was Miss Washington Parish when I was in high school.
She also dreamed of being a nurse and landed a job at the Hattiesburg Heart Clinic Dr. David Stevens had founded.
And we got to be very good friends working together.
Was it love at first sight?
No, because both of us were married.
Stephanie had moved to town with her husband and given birth to two daughters. For Dr. Stevens, Hattiesburg had been home for more than a decade. He'd been married to his wife, Karen, for 34 years. They had two children, Kristen and her older brother, Alan.
We were just laid back, everyday folk. I mean, we didn't expect people to treat us differently just because my father was a surgeon. It was just his job.
And these are some pictures of him taking care of patients. It's what he loved to do the best.
Before long, the young nurse of modest means says she began to fall for the man behind the surgeon's mask.
We both felt like we were in love and talked about it, and neither one of us were willing to leave our partners.
Stephanie and Dr. Stevens began an affair and betrayed their families.
I did not find out about the affair until my mother's accident.
It happened one day in 1995. When Stephanie decided to call Dr. Stevens' home.
And my mother had answered the phone.
Kristen says her mom suspected her husband was cheating, but until the phone call, didn't know with whom. Now she was devastated.
So she got a gun and she ran out into the driveway with it in her mouth and called his name. And she tripped and the gun went off.
Karen Stevens was rushed to the hospital with a gunshot wound to the head.
I was in shock. I was scared to death.
For 3 months, Kristen's mother lived in a coma, and then one night, she died. It was ruled a suicide.
My father was the one who had to tell me this, the story behind it, that he had been having an affair. And I couldn't be angry at him because I knew from his voice and from the words that he used to talk to me about it that he felt enormously guilty.
She licks my tears when I cry at night.
Stephanie says she felt guilty as well.
I did contribute to her death by having an affair with a married man and the consequences that go along with that.
And her own marriage fell apart too.
It was several months before I could actually look myself in the mirror. It was painful.
But she and Dr. Stevens seemed determined to move on. Just months later, right in front of the Stevens home where Karen had shot herself,
it's my most happy privilege to pronounce that they are husband and wife together.
David and Stephanie were married.
I thought it was too soon.
What did you think of Stephanie?
She wasn't my mother.
Massage lotion.
And she wasn't anywhere near the personality or the character of my mother.
But Stephanie says she was a loving wife. And stuck by her new husband even when he fell seriously ill in the summer of 2000.
He's so cute.
He was diagnosed with hepatitis C and was in liver failure and was on the liver transplant waiting list. And he also had diabetes.
So, hey, David.
As the brilliant doctor's condition declined, she says, his spirits did too.
The thought of having a long-term illness to a surgeon is unthinkable, and you talked about not wanting to go through having a transplant.
She didn't even care how he died as long as he was dead.
Kristen says Stephanie never loved her father. She loved his money. And 5 years after they were married,
David and Stephanie.
Hi.
On May 1st, 2001, Dr. David Stevens was dead. Stephanie claimed he had died in his sleep.
I was extremely shocked that he had died.
Kristen and her husband left home in North Carolina and rushed to Hattiesburg, suspecting foul play.
And when I walked into the bedroom, I knew immediately that she had done something to him. On the bed were all of my father's financial documents. who would be reading that sort of stuff not even 24 hours after their husband died.
Soon, tongues were wagging all over town.
I think she's guilty.
She's guilty.
Guilty.
He was the only parent that I had left.
Sit down.
There's times when I look at my son, David, who's named after my father, and I think about what my parents would think of him. And they would just have loved him. And those things have been taken away.
And Kristen is determined to make Stephanie pay.
So I shoved her up against the wall and I stared her right in the face and I said, "You killed my mother and you killed my father. And I hope you rot in hell, you bitch."
In Hattiesburg, we all know each other.
If it does that kind of damage to you, nobody will eat here again.
Hattiesburg, Mississippi is a town where everybody knows your name, especially if your name is Stephanie Stevens.
I was pretty much an outcast. It's just taboo. Taboo to help me, taboo to talk to me.
At the exclusive Hattiesburg Country Club, we found out why.
She was loud and she was, mm-hmm. did not present herself as a lady.
No.
And she stole another woman's husband.
Oh my God.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. I was shocked.
That's true. Mm-hmm.
Everybody was aghast. Yes. Yeah, and just couldn't believe it.
She was not too well received in Hattiesburg.
Every doctor's wife's nightmare is the younger woman that works at the hospital that captures the husband and marries him.
And David Stevens was no average doctor. He'd been chief of surgery at Hattiesburg Forest General Hospital. He was on the board there and at the university in town.
To steal a husband from a wife and children, and then to go on and do the other things that she did, she has got to be one without a lot of conscience.
Stephanie admits she is guilty of adultery.
I immediately was branded with the scarlet letter A.
But certainly not of murder. As Kristen Stevens and some people in town suggest.
I think she's guilty.
I believe she's guilty.
Probably guilty.
Just because people don't like me doesn't make me a killer.
So you have to concede, though, that all that's happened with the affair and everything else, it doesn't make you look good.
No, it makes me look bad.
It's got all the things of a good, wild novel.
In fact, Stephanie says, her life has been like a Greek tragedy.
That's a picture of David and I and my children at the wedding.
Soon after she married David Stevens in 1996, she was crippled in a car crash.
I roll around in my office chair. That works pretty well.
Then Dr. Stevens died. And the rumors about her involvement swept through town.
Our bed was there, and David slept on this side, and I slept on the other side.
The following year, the dream house they had built together...
They took everything.
...was robbed.
This room was trashed. This room is all the furniture that there is. The lack of finances after David died have caused the house to deteriorate a whole lot. And the yard is in disrepair, and the pool, and everything.
What keeps you going?
The truth keeps me going. That and my daughters.
Stephanie's daughters live nearby with her first husband.
But she's the most straight-laced student you'll ever, the straight-laced kid you'll ever see.
Crystal visits almost every day. The 16-year-old is her mother's only link to the outside world.
Bye, honey. They're the reason that life goes on. It's hard to stay focused on a reason to live.
Before David Stevens died, Stephanie says he was feeling the same way.
Both of us had a hard time dealing with, his illness.
Obviously, this had to affect his work as a surgeon.
Right, and income.
And the income.
Right.
Even with almost $1 million in a retirement fund, she says they worried about their future.
Was it tough financially?
Sure, it was tough. We'd gone from, you know, making a full surgeon's salary to disability.
For the man who once saved lives, seeing his own slip away was becoming unbearable. His liver was deteriorating, and his diabetes had become so severe, he had to wear a small pump with insulin in it.
Did it depress him?
Very much so.
By the spring of 2001, David Stevens was weak, disoriented, and rarely slept through the night. On the night of May 1st, Stephanie says, he tossed and turned for hours and fell asleep around dawn.
I woke up, and when I sat up in bed, I saw him. He was purple in the face, and I got up and ran around the side and pulled the covers back, and he was blue and not breathing. It was obvious he was dead and had been dead. You know, he was cool to the touch and blue. I knew that from being a nurse. I just laid there and cried, put my head on his chest and cried.
She called a family doctor, then 911. Before long, Coroner Butch Benedict was on the scene.
When we first got there, what we saw was Dr. Stevens was, appears to be like he died in his sleep.
David Stevens was lying on his back, arms crossed on his chest. His insulin pump was strapped to his side. Benedict says he thought he had an open and shut case until Stephanie opened her mouth.
The first thing that Stephanie was concerned about was that insulin pump. She wanted it back.
Right. The first thing that came to mind was to get the vials out.
Stephanie seemed in a hurry to remove the insulin container from the pump.
And of course that made you suspicious.
Exactly.
Yeah, this is Butch, Forest County.
When he ran blood tests on the body,
those chemicals in his body that shouldn't be there.
Those strange chemicals in his body and Stephanie's strange behavior convinced Benedict to contact Hattiesburg detective Rusty Keys.
Somebody was hiding something, and that sparked more of my curiosity, so I started digging even deeper.
The fact is that he died, whether he died accidentally or by his own hand, that's a question that I'll never know the answer to.
Stephanie claims that your dad was very, very ill and that he was very depressed. She's implying that he may have committed suicide. What do you say?
Absolutely not. He was not depressed. Stephanie wanted people to think my father was very sick because it was convenient for everybody to think he was very sick because they wouldn't question when he died.
And Kristen plans to help Detective Rusty Keys unmask a murderer.
Stephanie wanted to live the life of a socialite. She had the fancy house. She had the nice cars, the best clothes. She wanted it easy. She wanted it through Dr. Stevens' hard work. This man was murdered, and I was going to prove how.
The time that I spent with David was so good. It's hard to deny that that was the best years of my life. That's a picture of David and I right after we got married. We went on a cruise.
Stephanie Stevens insists she has no idea how the man of her dreams died next to her in bed.
You never prepare yourself for when you wake up and your husband's dead.
But Dr. Stevens' daughter, Kristen, doesn't buy a word of it.
She knew when she married my father he was sick. I don't think that he died quick enough for her, is what the problem was.
Kristen says Stephanie was counting on people assuming David Stevens died of natural causes and never thought Coroner Butch Benedict would do a blood test on the body.
There was a chemical in his blood that was usually given by anesthesiologists. So where did that drug come from? Because it should not be in his system.
The drug he found was Atomidate, an anesthetic made to knock patients out fast.
First, we had to find out how he could have got this Atomidate in his system. That's all we had.
Stephanie told Detective Rusty Keyes she'd never even heard of the drug.
It was obvious that we had to exhume Dr. Stevens to prove exactly how he died.
More tests produced more questions. There was another drug in David Stevens' body called Atricurium, used to relax muscles during surgery.
Take some nice deep breaths.
While patients are on life support. But without life support,
it will totally paralyze your heart, your lungs, and you will die.
Detective Keyes says these drugs act so fast, Dr. Stevens could not possibly have injected himself and cleaned up afterwards.
These drugs are so debilitating that if one were to inject themselves with it, the syringes would be laying around.
Oh, most definitely, body. Most definitely.
So the fact that they weren't there told you?
Well, that told me a lot. Somebody cleaned up. So then I knew that I had a homicide.
And the search for evidence led Detective Rusty Keyes to this document. Every year on May 1st, David Stevens' MetLife Pension Fund mailed him an option to cash out. He had always sent the form back declining. But suddenly, in 2001, the doctor wanted his money, almost $1 million. Detective Keyes noticed the signature on the document was dated April 30th, the day before he died. But on that date, MetLife hadn't even mailed the form out yet.
It was not mailed out from the home office till
May. Until May 1st.
Somebody wanted his money. Somebody wanted to continue living the lifestyle they were accustomed to.
Now he had more than just a homicide. He had a prime suspect.
She started spending money at a clip after his death.
Out that way? Okay.
Stephanie was coping well with the grief of losing her husband. So well, in fact, that a year later she married again. This time to a handyman named Chris Watts.
In the month of June of 2002, when she remarried, she received an $80,000 annuity that they spent in 4 weeks.
$80,000 in 4 weeks?
That's correct.
Stephanie admits that her behavior was reckless, but insists it actually shows how devastated she was that the love of her life was gone.
I don't need to advertise that. I don't need to tell anybody that. I need to tell anybody that I listen to certain songs and smell his clothes and go in his closet because I can still smell his scent. That makes me feel like he's still around.
And Stephanie says it was never about the money.
If I was so money hungry, it would have been much easier to just let him die from his illness and inherit the money that way versus trying to kill him. I mean, that doesn't make any sense.
Stephanie says she was so shocked when she found out how her husband died, she researched the drugs that killed him. And the registered nurse found something investigators failed to consider. The time it takes the drugs to work depends on how they're given. So, 48 Hours did some investigating of its own.
I'm going to give you some medicine now, all right? You're going to get very sleepy.
And it turns out, Stephanie may be right.
At this point, the anesthesiologist is injecting the Atomidate.
Dr. Alan Lisman is an anesthesiologist at Harvard Medical School and Boston's Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center.
Now, drug is into the intravenous line.
We asked him to show us how the drugs that kill Dr. Stevens work in surgery.
Patient's asleep.
40 seconds, pretty quick.
It's pretty quick, but that's because this drug is being given intravenously, as it was designed to be given.
But what if the anesthetics were given through an insulin pump under the skin?
In that case, the absorption of that drug would be much, much slower, and so that you wouldn't see effects of the drug for at least 5, 10, maybe even 15 minutes.
According to Dr. Lisman, it would have been possible for David Stevens to give himself a lethal dose of these drugs through his insulin pump and still have time to clean up afterwards. But Stephanie says nobody in Hattiesburg wanted to hear it.
Just elevated right there.
They simply singled me out and then tried to build facts around me to make a case.
In September 2002, 15 months after her husband died, Stephanie Stevens was arrested and charged with murder.
I've never been aware of any case in this area where somebody was so hated.
In a town rocked by scandal, Stephanie's lawyer, Ray Price, says his client is the victim of that hate.
Even the people who like her don't want it known that they do.
But prosecutor Keith Miller says Stephanie Stevens' story can be summed up with another word.
Greed.
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 One of the seven deadly sins. That got her.
Watch your step, huh?
Stephanie Stevens, on trial for murder, next on 48 Hours.
Stevens was arrested in August of this year.
Stevens is accused of murdering her heart surgeon husband, 59-year-old Dr. David Stevens.
After an autopsy showed traces of two anesthetic drugs in his system, she was later released on her own recognizance because of medical reasons.
Prosecutor and law enforcement officials believe you killed your husband. Let's set the record straight. Did you kill your husband?
No, I did not.
More than 2 years after Dr. David Stevens' death, his young widow, Stephanie, is about to stand trial for murder.
What's going through my mind is I know that I didn't do it, so I'm interested in seeing what kind of fictitious story they're going to come up with.
What happens if you're found guilty?
That's too much to think about.
Think we're going to win?
I bet you we will.
Stephanie's parents...
I'm here for moral support for my daughter.
And her older daughter, Crystal, are trying to help her stay strong.
I don't have any doubt she didn't do it.
Is there any doubt in your mind that she killed her husband?
No, no doubt.
Proving murder beyond a reasonable doubt will be up to prosecutor Keith Miller.
All rise, please.
Bring the jury on in.
She's the only one that was with him for the 24 hours, the last 24 hours of his life. And he shows up with Atricurium and Atomidate in his system.
Kristen, how are you feeling this morning?
Well, I'm nervous, but also a little bit relieved that soon it will be over and we can move on.
For Dr. Stevens' daughter, Kristen, moving on means seeing justice served.
Now, order, please. The bank's seated to come to order.
Ladies and gentlemen, we begin with the state of Mississippi.
You already know that Dr. David Stevens is the victim in this case.
Prosecutors begin by telling the jury that Stephanie's lust for money, her expertise as a nurse, and behavior after her husband died lay out like a roadmap to murder.
This case is like a Greek tragedy.
But defense lawyer Ray Price warns jurors not to be distracted by twists and turns in the road.
The Hattiesburg Police Department, specifically through one officer, Rusty Keyes, consistently sought out only one kind of evidence. They only wanted to do one thing, and that was prove Stephanie Stevens was a murderer. They didn't want to find the truth.
He says this is a witch hunt to frame Stephanie for killing Dr. Stevens, when the doctor really killed himself. Price knows even the possibility of suicide could raise reasonable doubt with the jury.
Is it possible in this particular case, in your professional opinion, that Dr. Stevens committed suicide?
No, that is not an option, that he committed suicide.
But Price has news for Rusty Keyes. David Stevens was in therapy for depression, though his therapist has declined to testify.
Would you have liked to know that Dr. Stevens, in fact, had been diagnosed depressed?
My investigation never went that way. Mr. Price, I've gathered the facts in this case, and I'm going to stand by what I've gathered.
Even if your facts change?
I don't believe they will.
The defense seems to be scoring points, but prosecutors are about to stun everyone in court. They say Stephanie actually admitted killing her husband. And they have three witnesses to prove it.
Who do you have next?
Just we have Karen Burnett.
The first is Karen Burnett, a friend of Stephanie and Chris Watts, who went to their Las Vegas wedding just a year after David Stevens died. It was there, she says, that Stephanie took a gamble by confiding in her.
She told me that he had expressed to her that he wanted to die, and he asked her to help him. And she told me that she injected him with two sedatives and a heart medication, I believe.
But Ray Price points out his client is on trial for murder, not assisted suicide. Besides, he argues, Karen Burnett should be on trial herself.
Has anybody charged you with burglary?
No, sir.
They took everything.
Remember the burglary where Stephanie says she lost all the creature comforts of home?
Did you steal items from Stephanie Stevens' house?
No, I did not.
You did not?
No, I did not.
These are some of the items stolen from Stephanie Stevens' home. They're in police custody now, but they were recovered from a storage locker registered to the prosecution's star witness, Karen Burnett.
Do you have an explanation to give this jury as to how those items from Stephanie Stevens' house got into your storage unit?
No, sir.
None at all?
No, sir.
Ray Price thinks Karen Burnett was involved in the burglary and made a deal with the state. Testify against Stephanie in return for immunity.
Burnett had nothing to do with the robbery.
That's right.
You made no deal with her.
No.
Prosecutors say Karen Burnett's husband, John.
Mr. Burnett, have a seat over here, please.
Also heard Stephanie's admission in Las Vegas. But when he takes the stand, he takes something else, too.
Can I take the fifth on this?
I wish to take the fifth on that.
I wish to take the fifth on that also.
No further questions.
The state's third witness, Stephanie's new husband, Chris Watts, never shows up in court. He's serving 7 years in prison for trying to have his ex-girlfriend killed.
What are some methods?
The hitmen he hired were actually federal agents with a hidden camera.
It's everything from slitting her throat to putting a bullet in the back of her head.
Stephanie believes the state's star witnesses have fallen.
This is going really well.
Did you ever tell anyone that you killed David?
No.
Will you testify? Will you take the stand?
If my attorney thinks it's in my best interest, I will.
All right, we'll be in recess until 5 minutes after 2.
But Stephanie isn't doing well in the court of public opinion. Mac Johnson and her friends from the country club have been watching from the wings.
I would be sitting over there weeping and hoping that somebody in that jury would see that I was a poor little innocent somebody, and I would never, ever kill my husband. But she was flirting around, carrying on, laughing and talking like, I'm innocent. There's nothing wrong here.
I ain't seen it come to all.
I'd call Kristen Stevens.
All right. Kristen Stevens.
Kristen Stevens has been waiting for 2 years to tell the court about the father she loved.
He was a gentle and kind man, full of wisdom. I loved him dearly, and I miss him a lot every day.
And she wants to make sure the jury knows just how she lost him.
If someone were to tell me that my father committed suicide, I wouldn't believe it. It wasn't possible, having known my father, for that even to be an option. I don't care what kind of evidence you have.
You definitely do not want to admit that to this jury, do you?
It's not that I don't want to admit it. To me, that's fact. My father would have never committed suicide.
But defense lawyer Price has a bombshell witness.
Do you have an opinion as to whether or not Dr. Stevens committed suicide?
A witness whose testimony,
I do have an opinion,
might set Stephanie free. If the crowd in the Hattiesburg courthouse is any gauge of how Stephanie Stevens' murder trial is going,
you ready, Judge?
Stephanie may be in for a shock.
I want a guilty verdict.
Her stepdaughter Kristen says The shock will be if Stephanie walks free.
And I want her to spend the rest of her life in prison. And then I will go on with my life, and this will be a closed door.
But Stephanie is doggedly optimistic.
And she may have good reason to be. The defense attorney has a witness he thinks will silence the skeptics and sell the jury by saying Dr. David Stevens was a textbook suicide risk.
Dr. Gerald O'Brien.
Dr. Gerald O'Brien, a psychologist brought in to review the case, says warning signs were everywhere.
He had a terminal illness. He also had a history of drinking regularly. The records indicate that his grandfather either attempted or committed suicide.
But what's most striking, O'Brien says, is the date David Stevens died, May 1st, 2001.
People place significance on anniversaries.
6 years to the day after his first wife's funeral.
Suicide would have to be considered a very realistic possibility in this case.
You got all your records for your opinion here today from the defense attorney.
Prosecutor Keith Miller says Dr. O'Brien is nothing more than a hired gun, taking shots in the dark. Still, Stephanie and her lawyer have to make a critical decision, whether the jury should hear from her directly.
I have nothing to hide, and I think people want to hear my side of the story.
But Stephanie's acting strangely. She seems sedated.
I had such a rough night last night, not sleeping, and my leg hurting.
She wanted to tell her story. We just couldn't take the risk.
So, as the lawyers offer closing arguments,
Stephanie Stevens is not guilty.
To return a verdict of guilty of murder against Stephanie Stevens.
Stephanie can only watch.
Jury's out.
And wait for her fate to be decided.
It's very scary. Very scary.
But it turns out nobody has to wait very long.
You ready? Go get the judge.
After only 90 minutes, the jury comes back with a verdict.
I understand that you have reached a verdict. Is that correct? Mr. Price, would you and your client please rise? I'll ask the clerk to publish the verdict.
We, the jury, find the defendant, Stephanie Stevens, guilty of murder.
The words hit the courtroom like a shockwave.
I looked at my daughter and I saw the shock on her face. That just felt like my soul being ripped out.
Ms. Stevens, you ended a life.
Immediately after the verdict, Judge Jess Dickinson hands down her punishment.
The court hereby sentences you to life imprisonment.
Stephanie Stevens will serve at least the next 30 years in prison, an emotional victory for the detective.
It's just a relief to me. I'm sorry.
Who worked so hard to put her there.
Justice has been served and feel good.
Stephanie, you never thought this would happen, did
you? Never thought it would happen.
In one agonizing instant, Stephanie leaves her daughter behind, along with the life she's always known. She enters a new world where the reality hits home.
I left my curlers out. I left, you know, my clothes ready for the morning.
That she may never go home again.
I used your earrings. Do you have any other jewelry on watch? Right there, and this is the list of things I took from. I'll tell you right, just a little bit. Right there.
I don't think she was at all prepared. Well, obviously, they thought she was guilty of something.
I was honestly just shocked. I had told you this before. I had not prepared for the worst. I had prepared. We had prepared to win.
She may have lost the trial.
I'll be fine.
But Stephanie Stevens defiantly says she will never lose hope.
I've been pushed around and talked about and had all kind of bad things said about me, and it hurts, but I managed okay.
Good show, girl.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Dixie, for showing your support.
Okay. You were seeking justice. Do you feel you got it?
Yes, I do.
Justice has been served.